yeah. Oh no, to prison you will go. Let me tell you the story about Igor, Lev, and Rudy. You can just follow the money, because that's where the story goes. Igor was a Belarusian, and Lev was a Ukrainian. They had a rich Russian connection, and they peddled the theory that Ukraine, not Putin, meddled in the last election in 2016. They met up with Rudy as they were in the same circles, coincidentally. Had dinner often at Trump's hotel in Washington, D.C. They played golf, went to parties, and even did some business together. They've gotten to be good pals pretty quickly, you see. Ooh. Rudy was to live for a year in 2017. $500,000 for his now defunct company, ironically called Fraud Guarantee, while funneling hundreds of thousands of secret Russian money to the GOP illegally. How much Rudy knew no one else knows, you see. Now Rudy had heard a rumor going round on some right-wing websites that they were calling it CloudStrike. It had grown into a full-fledged conspiracy theory about the missing email server from Hillary in the DNC. He got excited as he dreamed of exoneration. And though disproven through and through, it fast became Trump's top priority. The claim it was somewhere in Ukraine, and a treasure trove of emails it did contain. Now at this point it gets hard to explain that the Democrats hacked themselves to frame poor Putin by Mueller so unfairly blamed. And over and above that Ukrainian angle, the CEO of Burisma was up to his neck in corruption in 2014. And he put on the board an American for $50,000 a month for some reason. His only qualification, he was the vice president's son. So one day Rudy said, "Hey, friend, it occurs to me you speak Ukrainian. And I want to find out some more as to what happened, especially anything about Burisma and Hunter Biden." Lev responded, "Coincidentally, I can help you. We know some people back home can talk to you. Igor and I know just what to do. I can hook you up whenever you want me to." And Rudy said, "By all means, let's do that soon." Let's do that soon. So Rudy flew over to Kiev in search of some more corroboration, and met with the source of the story, a shady character with ties to the Russians. He made a lot of wild allegations. There was only one tiny problem. The U.S. ambassador was on to them. She would defy them and expose their corruption. But Trump did not fire immediately. Then things started getting a little bit out of hand. For Igor and Lev, the shit hit the fan. Subpoenaed for the illegal campaign donations. They said they would not testify to the press. And the very next day, with one-way tickets to Kiev, the FBI at the airport made their arrest. But meanwhile, the president on a call to Zelensky was revealed by a whistleblower, extortion and bribery. Do me a favor, though, means quid pro quo, you see. And when you ask a foreign government to investigate your political enemies, after what happened with the Russians in 2016 especially, and the very next day, after Mueller's House testimony, Nancy Pelosi finally called him to be impeached. And the pictures on the news of Trump and Trump Jr. and Pence laughing it up with Igor Lev and Rudy at some fundraising events. And the official partial transcripts released by the president. And when Donald was asked if he knew Igor and Lev, he answered perfectly, "I don't recall ever meeting them." Which must have pissed off Lev, because he just turned over evidence in his own incriminating statement. Now Igor and Lev are out of jail on ankle bracelets and $1 million bail. And Rudy is under investigation. I doubt he will see vindication. And Trump will do what he must. Maybe throw him under the bus. He got himself a lawyer, because he needs one. So that's the story of Igor Lev and Rudy, how they ended up with Ukrainian woes. And Trump's impeachment woes is preposterously sad and funny. Ooh, you can just follow the money, because that's where